try to just see why video is not coming. Otherwise,
sir, don't bother, sir. Don't worry, sir. It's fine, completely fine.
Yeah,
it's okay. Yes, Tarak, sir, please carry on.
So, good morning, everyone, and you are welcome for the second session. So, in second session, we have my guru, Dr. B.J. Shah, sir, with us. Sir is a principal and professor in Government Engineering College, Modasa. He is teaching various subjects related to structural engineering in undergraduate as well as postgraduate level. Sir has guided many master degree courses as well as PhD students also. Sir is involved in various activities related to research and development work. He has been continuously involved in various consultancy projects in the area of analysis and design of structures, as well as third party checking and design of drawing for structural health monitoring and field testing. Sir is a part of administrative duty of the institute and also the member of various policy matter in the state, technical education and in universities. So, actually, sir is the teacher by heart, that I can say, and I'm sure that this session that will be really helpful. You will find all the basic concepts of the design of bridge, whether it is a reinforced concrete bridge or prestress concrete bridge. So you will get all the in and outs. And with this note, I will request sir to take over the charge of the session. And sir, you may.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Sir can share the screen.
Yeah, so sir can share this. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Actually, I'm just check my video, but video is not somehow working. So I'm not able to just join with the video. But I think the audio is available, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So let us just be allow with only audio. I want that all I can all the participants can see me, but unfortunately I don't know, somehow electronic gadgets are also somehow not responding to our expectations, right?
Yes.
Many times many things are not in our hands, so people has to just always whatever available resources are there, available things are there, from that how best we can obtain or how best we can do the things, so that can be there. So this is the just the message of this morning, and with this message, whatever best we can do, I think we try to do it, right? So anyway, video is not working, but my audio is there. So with this thing, let us start with the sessions. Most of the thing I will be talking with my presentation, so I think there won't be any trouble. Presentation is already loaded. So very good morning to all the participants, and good morning to all the organizers of this event. Today I'm going to discuss about the analysis and design of reinforced and prestress concrete design, prestress concrete bridges, right? So I'll share my screen, and with this thing we can start with the discussion of today's one, right? So I'll just I have already shared the screen. Yeah. So I think my screen is visible to.
Yes, sir. It is visible.
All of you. Yeah. Right.
Yes.
So with this thing, I'll just who can share? I'll give only host or. The message is there. Some message I can let be closed. Okay. So this is perhaps the first slide.
Yes, sir. What is bridge? That slide is invisible.
Okay. Yeah. No, one second, I'm going to share my screen. Okay, so let us start with the bridge. What is bridge? Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. It is
okay. So basically, the bridge is a structure which is normally used to cover the gap. Wherever the gap is there in any transportation system, to cover this gap, we need to put a bridge. So a bridge is basically the most significant component of any transportation system that we are knowing very well, because nowadays over the country, all over the country, most of all the roads and bridges are going to be put it in a very new form. So I think most of you might have experienced the quality of the roads and the passage which we are going to get it through the road, which is found to be so comfortable that now it's very easy to do a journey through our vehicle. So it's a most significant component of the transportation system in case of communication over the gaps, for which whatever the reason is there, whether it is aquatic obstacles or valley or gorges, whatever is there, whenever we want to just cross these obstacles, then we need to provide a bridges. Generally, the bridges carries a road or railway across a natural or the artificial obstacles like a river, canal, or other railway systems. Bridge is basically a key element in the transportation systems which carries the heaviest responsibilities. As we have seen that a lot of cross drainage works are, CD cross drainage works are there, or many obstacles due to either a crossroads or the railways. So such type of obstacles are there. And whenever we want to cross such obstacles, then we need to provide a bridge, right? So this is one of the very important element, particularly in a highway sector. Or to cross the roads, right? Bridges are expensive also. If you just count the total cost of the highways, in which nearly or sometimes more than 50% of the costs are there for the bridges, whether it's a minor bridge, major bridge, or whatever kind of, whether it's a culverts or minor bridge or major bridge, more than 50% cost are there for the bridges. If you just have this typical cost of the bridges per kilometer, you will find out somewhat more than 50,000 rupees per kilometer. That is approximately. I just quoted here a very approximate cost, but that is in the range of somewhat about more than rupees 50,000 per running meter. So that is why if you see that if the bridge fails, then the entire system fails. The importance of the bridge, this can be visualized by considering the comparison between the two main components of the highway system, that is a road and the bridge. So we can see that as per the ASTO, any structures which is having an opening not less than 6.1 meter that forms a part of the highway or that located over or under a highway, that is normally known as a bridge. If it is less than 6 meter, then it will be normally put it as a culvert. And this kind of culverts you might have seen on many highways, whether it is going to be renovated or upgraded or such kind of a things. So we can see that bridges are having an importance from many perspectives, like people's life, that is in terms of social, education, employment, entertainment. There are so many aspects are there as far as the people's life is concerned. Similarly, from economic point of view, see, this is one of the very important thing for any either it is undeveloped countries or developing countries or the developed countries. See, most of the time we have seen developed countries like United States, Japan. You can see the type and quality of the roads or even the road network. This is a very important part as far as the economy is concerned, because major economy of the country is basically drive through its transportation system. So that is why in any transportation logistic system, transportation systems, if it is strong and good, accordingly the economy will be boosted. So from economic point of view, bridges are very, very important. On any chain, whenever any bridges fails, then the entire, what we can say, the transportation or logistic would be stuck off. So that is why this is the importance of the bridges, that failure of the bridge will completely prevent completely prevent the transportation network. So that is why logistic part and transportation point of view, the bridges are very, very important. Same thing is also true for the political point, government security. You might have seen that our countries are surrounded by so many enemies like China, Pakistan, and other countries are also there, right? So from a defense point of view, many times it is very difficult to reach to a very critical point. We have seen, we have experienced during Kargil war that we could not reach to a place because we do not have a proper road network at that time. Right? So this kind of a thing, government later on realized, understood, and decided to create a road network on the periphery of the country. Right? So government has now started to think in these directions. And accordingly, the Leh-Ladakh highway, the Atal Tunnel that is created, and through which now we can reach to a very critical point like a Kargil. So nowadays, all the government has also understand the importance of these political issues. And accordingly, the bridges are also one of the very important elements, right? So am I audible, Tarak, properly? Hello.
Yes, sir. It is audible. Okay.
So let us go with some of the, before I will go with the analysis and design, because the bridges are one of the very important part of the road infrastructures. So have some of the, what we can say, the audit, how, what and where we are. So you will have, you will get the importance of the bridges, because bridges is one of the very important element of the road infrastructures. India is the second largest road network in the world. spanning a total of 5.89 million kilometers. This road network transports 64.5% of all goods in the country, and 90% of the India's total passenger traffic uses road network to commute. Highway construction in India increased at 17% of CAGR between financial year 16 to 21. Despite pandemic and lockdown, India has constructed, these are the recent, even after this pandemic. So during pandemic and lockdown also, India has constructed 13,000 kilometers of highway in financial year 2020, financial year 21. In May 2021, Ministry of Road Transport and Highway, basically it is a regulating authority. So they have constructed 1,470 kilometers of national highway compared with 847 kilometers in May 2020. Government of India has also allocated ₹111 lakh crore under the National Infrastructures Pipeline for financial year 19 to 25. Under phase one, Bharatmala Pariyojana, many of you might be knowing this Bharatmala Pariyojana. The ministry has approved the implementation of 34,800 kilometers of national highway in 5 years, with an outlay of ₹5,35,000 crore. And under this scheme, 22 greenfield projects are being constructed. This is worth ₹3.20 lakh crores. The government also aims to construct 23 new national highways by 2025. Under the Union Budget 2021-22, the Government of India has allocated ₹1,08,000 crore to the Ministry of Road Transport and Highway. And what is the road ahead? So government, through a series of initiatives, is working on the policies to attract the significant investor interest. A total 2 lakh kilometer of national highway is expected to be completed by 2021. And in the next 5 years, National Highway Authority of India, NHAI, will be able to generate ₹1 lakh crore annually from the toll and other sources. So you see, most of now National Highway is also constructed on the on this pattern, toll road, and about 1 lakh crores are going to get it, because ultimately from where the money will be coming. So money is coming from such kind of a toll, and that will be utilizing for this thing. So with this, I think huge investment in the road sector, road infrastructures, and bridges is being one of the important element of the road infrastructures. I think analysis and design of the bridges is one of the very, very important topic of this One Big Train program. So I'll be going with, of course, in a few session, I'm not going to meet you expert of this thing, but I'll just go briefly the various issues which are related to the analysis and design, and which will be very much helpful to you to further, if anybody is interested to make your career, so that will be helpful to you. Right. So with this thing, content, I'll go with some of the initial content just to explain you the various component of the bridges, because when we are going for the design, you must understand the different components which are to be there. And then after, I'll be discussing more about a traditional bridge. Traditional bridges, either it will be a RCC or it will be a PSC. Most of majority of the bridges are of this nature. Some long span bridges, when it is going to be a span more than 50 meters, 60 meters or so, then we need to think of a specific form of the superstructure and substructures. So which I will just cover it in my presentation, but detailed design aspect we are not going to discuss about it, because every bridge is considered to be as individual, such kind of a signature or special kind of a bridges. Every bridges are having their own method, own way it is going to be different. So we'll just have a look of it, but we are not going to discuss more about the design aspect. And construction, of course, because nowadays a lot of mechanization and automations are going on as far as the construction of the bridges are concerned. So which we are going to discuss, and advanced construction, some of the advanced construction practices we are trying to get it through the video. So I'll show you some of the videos which showing you some of the advanced construction practice which are nowadays already started in our country also. In our country, such kind of advanced construction practice are being adopted, started, and that is why you might have seen that all the bridges are nowadays constructed without having any hindrances of daily traffic. Of course, sometimes some stopgap arrangements are required, but the traffic flow is going on as it is, and construction of the bridges are going on, right? So both the things are parallelly going on. So without hindering the daily traffic, the construction is going on. So that is really a big achievement, because otherwise you can think of some of the roads are to be closed for a number of days. It creates a lot of trouble to many people those who are traveling on it, right? So with this thing, I'll start with some of the things right from the beginning. If we have the historical right from the Indian civilization or human being, the history of the bridges, I think we can start from that in those days. From the very beginning, people were using just use a log or a wood or a tree just to cross such kind of a small drains. Whenever the drains are passing and people want to just cross these drains, such kind of a wooden logs, they are using it. Slowly and gradually, in the Roman Empire, I think people have started to use it bridges with the help of a timber and masonry. So we can see a beautiful curvature bridges in the Roman Empire. Then after in the European, after following the Holy Roman Empire, steel and steel is widely used during the European time, and many steel bridges you found it which were constructed during the European days, and still working very nicely, working very well till today. And then in the 19th century, modern longspan bridges, movable bridges have come up, because during this period, concrete and steel both have been extensively used in the construction of bridges. So these materials are widely used in the construction of bridges. So this is just see how the people were crossing in the earlier days. Can we call it as a beam or cantilever, suspension, or the arch or truss? These are the different structural element you might have used during, you might have seen during the study, and how the beam behaves, how the cantilever behaves, how the suspension members or arch or truss. So basic principle of these basic element we have studied during the structural engineering. So these principles, these kind of principles, we can use it while designing the bridges. Historic days, we have seen the stone, kind of stone were used, simple logs or bamboo or stones were used just to cross the river. So these were the very early days where the stones and logs or bamboos were used, right? Then during Roman periods, these are some of the sketches which you can see that stones were widely used for making such kind of arches, right? And stone arch bridges were prepared by the Roman very well during in Italy, in Spain. So such kind of aesthetically looking bridges are found during the Roman periods. Then after this also example of the Baozhu bridge in China, stone arch bridge which is made up of a 65 meter length, 9 meter width, so 65 meter length bridge is to be made during the period of 595 to 600 AD, right? So this is the middle age bridges. Some of the industrial revolution, which you can get it, see, this is the longest Cincinnati, Ohio, USA. The suspension bridge of a longest span of 322 meter, and total length of the bridge is of 650 meter, clearance is about 30 meter, right? So this is made in 1866. Golden Gate Bridge, San Francisco, USA, in 1937. We can see that the longest span of somewhat about 1200 meter, vertical clearance of 4.3 meter, total width of 27 meter, height is 227 meter. And total length of the bridge is 2,002.7 kilometer. So it is a golden gate bridge, very beautiful, aesthetically looking very well, that is created in the 1937. In our country also, Howrah Bridge, Rabindra Setu, Calcutta, which is constructed in 1943, 8-lane, that is on the river Hooghly, suspension type. Total length of 700 meter and a longest span of somewhat about 450 meter. And so beautiful Howrah Bridge, people would always like whenever they move to Kolkata, get the picture of this Howrah Bridge. And 21st century bridge, Milau Viaduct. Nowadays it is considered to be one of the tallest bridge, constructed in 2004. Total length of, it is a cable stay kind of a thing, and 2,460 meter. Height is 343 meter. When you travel on this bridge, many times the clouds are passing through, touching through you, and found a very thrilling experience while traveling on this Milau Bridge. 343 meter from the ground, and the longest span is somewhat about 342 meter, six of 342 meters are there, and the end two spans are of 204 meters are there. And so altogether, the total length of the bridge is 2,460 meter. So these are some of the river bridges which are constructed on the river. Many rivers are there. Like railway bridges, when it is crosses on the railway, it is known as a railway bridges. And flyover, this is nowadays, you found this kind of a picture you found in many metro cities like Ahmedabad, Mumbai, Delhi, Mumbai, Delhi. You will find out the highways at the different levels, different elevations. So a high level underpass that crosses over a highway interchange or the intersection, and particularly at the busy junction of a road, any of the road is to be elevated by the bridges. So many times it is also called elevated bridges, but nowadays it is a need of such kind of infrastructures in majority of all the metro cities. And so these are the flyovers. Railway bridges, many cities like Delhi, Mumbai, and metro cities like Ahmedabad, they are going for such kind of a metro for a mass transportation. So you might have seen in Ahmedabad also the metro construction is going on. Likewise, on the same line of pattern, all the countries where such kind of a metro constructions are going on. So a bridges to carry a metro road special bridges are required to be there, a metro for elevated. So it is a Las Vegas monorail, but these kind of a pictures now you find out in our country also in majority of the metro cities. Pedestrian bridge, many times we need to also create a pedestrian bridge to transport the people from one end to other end of the road. Very heavy roads are there, people are not able to found to cross the roads. So foot over bridges, skywalk, subway, these are the different names which is given, but ultimately it is used to just cross the roads by the pedestrians. So pedestrian bridges are there, and I think this is the last development which is there. See, many times these highways are also to be used for the landing of the aircraft. And you see that in our country also, the Union Minister inaugurates the India's first airstrip on the national highway in Barmer, that is in Rajasthan, under the Bharatmala project on National Highway 925A. A 5 kilometer long airstrip is to be made near Gandhav. Right? So this is the things nowadays the people are also using the highway as a runway. And accordingly, the design of highway is required to be carried out. Right? So whenever the 5 kilometer long step is there, you might be experienced that there may be many obstacles, and wherever there is obstacles, the bridges needs to be created. So nowadays the bridges are also such kind of a very specialized runway, very specialized airstrips. Highways can be designed as airstrips, and it is also being designed like this. Right? So this is the latest development which is going on as far as the highway is concerned, and bridges are also required to be designed for such kind of the roads. Aqueduct, the bridges that can be constructed to convey water over the obstacles, such like as a valley. And this is the beautiful examples during the Roman days, such kind of things, the bridges were used for such kind of aqueducts. Finally, if we see the bridges, there are many ways the bridges can be classified, depends on the different attributes. It can be based on the functions, whether it's a railway bridge, road over bridge, or many other, based on the function, flyovers or pedestrian bridge or something like that. Based on the material or material of the construction of the superstructure, how it is being there, whether it is a reinforced concrete bridge or a prestressed concrete bridge or steel bridge. Nowadays, the steel bridges are also used. Steel concrete composite bridges are also being used. So based on the material of construction, it can be also identified. It can be also classified based on the form of the superstructures. Many times, this is also widely used in the classification of the bridges, form of the superstructures. It may be a slab type superstructures. It may be a slab and beam type superstructures. So that is known as a T girder kind of a superstructures. It may be a box kind of a superstructures, right? It may be a voided slab kind of a superstructure. So depends on what kind of superstructures are there, it will be known as. Most of the time it is decided based on what is your span. So span arrangement, whether the span is small, it may be a slab type superstructures. And then after progressively as the span increases, we can go from a T-beam kind of, T-girder kind of a superstructures to a box type of superstructures, right? So form of superstructure is a very, very important thing, because it is decided based on what is the span requirement. Accordingly, the form of the superstructure is designed or decided. According to interspan relationship, it may be a simply supported or it may be a continuous. Nowadays, the continuous superstructure are used to reduce the number of joints. As we know that the joints creates always a problem during the usage. In the initial days, it's okay, but because of the vehicle vibration or jerks, these joints are always open up, and later on, once the joint destroys, it will create an effect on entire functions on the that is working on the bridges. So that is why people have now slowly and gradually started for continuous, so continuity of 2-span, 3-span, 4-span. Of course, it's a very challenging task to go for a continuous superstructures, but nowadays it is started to go for at least 2 to 3 span of continuity, 2, 3, 4 span of continuity. It is already started, right? According to the road level, relative to the highest flood level, it may be a overbridge or it may be a causeway. Causeway may be used initially for the low cost, but now it may be used for the village bridge, a village road, or then major district road. It can be there. But later on, when the vehicle movement will be more, the causeway can be removed. According to the length of the bridge, this is one of the very important classification of the bridges. If the length is less than 6 meter, it will be known as a culvert. And then it can be a minor bridge and it can be a major bridge, right? So IRC has prescribed the qualification classification based on the length of the bridges, whether it's a culvert or whether it is a bridge. And according to the anticipated type of the services and duration of the use, whether it is being used for the short duration for the military purpose, defense purpose, so it will be accordingly classified, depends on the anticipated services and duration. Component, whenever we go for design of bridges, then first of all we need to understand which are the component. So finally, if we see that superstructure, substructure and foundation, these are the three major components are there. Superstructure is the component which receives the load immediately and then passing through the substructures, wherein in between a very special elements is called a bearings. So in between superstructure to substructures, the bearings are provided. Nowadays, the bearing-less bridges are also being started, right? But still majority of, because there are a lot of challenges are there in the bearing-less bridges. So still majority of the bridges are of this category where the bearings are provided, right? Because in a very short space, very small area, very high loads are going to be transferred. So that is why we need to provide a arrangement of a bearing so that all the loads will be transferred very effectively from substructure to the, from superstructure to the substructures. And substructures which basically transfer the loads to the ground, to the foundation. So we need to provide vertical elements like abutment or piers or walls. So substructures where abutment, pier, walls are provided, and then below which there is a foundation. Again, in a foundation, if the good soils are there, we can go for a open foundation. If the soil is not good and weak soil is there, then we can go for a deep foundations. Most of the time, we need to go for a deep foundation because very few sites are there where we are able to get a good soil condition. And that is why open foundations are very rare options. Of course, it is there wherever good soil is available. Superstructure, if it is concerned, we have seen that there are different types of the superstructure. This is a slab type superstructures, slab and beam type of superstructure, and cellular, or sometimes it is called a box type superstructures. Right? Slab type superstructures are used for a lesser span, let us say up to 10 meter or so, we can go for a slab type. Again, we can increase the moment of resistance by introducing a voids, or we can go for a composite like a slab. We can introduce such kind of a things. We can go for a variable thickness also, uniform thickness, variable thickness. We can introduce a voids, and we can also call a voided slab kind of a superstructures. So these are the various options are there. And depends on the moment of resistance required, we can go for providing solid slab or composite or voided slab. Then next is very popular, and majority of the bridges you found, that is of the slab and beam type. So slab and beam, which are monolithically casted, sometimes we may go for a steel beam and concrete slab. So composite sections we can also go for. This is all depends on the requirement of the design forces and availability of the material and the economics, because economics is also governing. So whether we can go for a reinforced concrete slab and beam, or prestressed concrete slab and beam, or we can go for a steel concrete composite. So steel beams are there and concrete slabs are there. So these all the varieties are widely used in the bridges. And then after a cellular type, that is called a box type. So where the span requirement is more, if it is more than 30 meter, 40 meter, then the girder kind of the things are found to be economical, because a very large depth of the girder is required in these situations. And when we go for providing a large depth, the headroom requirement that is going to be restricted. So that is why in these situations one can go for a box type superstructures, and there may be a single box or multiple box, depend on the number of the carriage by width which is required, carriage by width which is required to be accommodated, right? So box type of superstructures is widely used for a larger span, and wherever there is a skewness in the bridges or wherever there is a curvature, so curved bridges are there, the box type of superstructures are very popular in this kind of situations or in this kind of condition. Second part, important part is a bearing. Various kinds of bearings, earlier days the rocker and roller bearings were used, even metallic bearing, elastomeric bearings were used, but nowadays the port PTFE kind of a bearings are widely used. It is the more advanced solutions for these bearings, and bearings basically required to provide for allowing a translation in longitudinal direction, in translation, transverse direction. Longitudinal direction is the direction which is called in the direction where the traffic is moving. This direction is normally called a longitudinal direction, and perpendicular to the traffic direction is cross is called a transverse direction. So longitudinal direction, transverse direction, we need to allow a certain movement. Otherwise, there is a concentration, stress concentration would take place, and we need to design for the negative forces, also negative reinforcement is also. This is most of the time avoiding wherever continuous superstructures are there, these negative reinforcements are to be provided. But otherwise, by providing a bearing, we can make it as simply supported, and we can allow the movement in the longitudinal direction, in the transverse direction, in the rotational direction. All such movements are nowadays allowed very well by having a different kinds of a bearing, that is a fixed bearing, free bearing, guided bearing. So various kind of these mechanical devices are now used to allow a movement. Of course, it is a certain definite movement it is allowed, and this is one of the design criteria. In the design, one has to prescribe that what amount of movements you need to allow, and accordingly the bearings are being designed. It's a mechanical component is there, but all the design criteria we need to give, we need to provide in the design of the bearing. So all these bearings, port PTFE is the material which is used for having a bearing for allowing a movement in longitudinal direction, transverse direction, rotational directions, that is to be there. Elastomeric bearing, you might have seen the last sketch. That is the sketch of the elastomeric bearing, which were used in the earlier days. It's a one kind of a pad, which is a layered pad, right? So steel plates is embedded between the rubbers, and the different layers of the steels and the rubbers are put it and just plugged together, so which can allow a certain amount of the rotational movement as well as longitudinal and transverse movement. So which were widely used in these earlier days, but now it is being slowly and gradually replaced to a port PTFE kind of a bearing. Superstructures, again, there are wide varieties because major loads will be transferred from superstructures, and that is why these are most of the time a cantilever kind of elements, right? So loads from superstructure will transferred to the substructures. So it's a very important element, and the collapse of substructures will ultimately collapse the entire bridges. So this is one of the very important element of the bridge structures. It is just like as the legs of the human beings, and how important the legs of the human beings are there. So likewise, this is we called the legs of the bridges. If it is going to fail, then the entire bridge is going to collapse. So whenever we design, we have to take care of all the forces which are going to transport on it. And accordingly, we need to ensure that it would be work in a proper, so ductility and debris, all the aspects are required to be seen properly in the design of the substructures, right? Various shapes are there, circular, circular, vault type, polo circular, multiple column, So different options are available as far as the substructure is concerned. Foundation we have discussed. There is a open foundation, pile foundation, well foundation. Pile and well foundations are used as for a deep foundation, and open foundation. If a good soil is available, then one can go for a open foundation. Otherwise, one has to go for a pile as well as well foundation. Okay. So altogether, this is the brief sketch showing you the superstructures, which part covers the superstructures, which part covers the substructures, and which part covers the foundation. See, whenever we talk about the superstructures, so there is a different components in the superstructure, starting from the top or deck slab. Over the deck slab, again, there are many components like a crash barriers, wearing courts, footpath, railing, right? So many different things are there. Then below the deck, because deck is supported by the girders. So I'm talking about a very traditional kind of a bridges where girder or the even box also the similar kind of situation is there. Okay, so box as well as girder, as far as the behavior point of view is concerned, it will be nearly same. So that is why the girder kind of a system, and the girder will transfer, will again seated on the pedestal, which is already there on the cap, so pier cap. And from pier cap or abutment cap, from cap level, the substructure will start. And then below the ground, there is a foundation. So likewise, substructure, superstructure, substructure, and foundation. These are the three basic element of the basic component of the bridges. Talk about a superstructures. We have seen various forms of the superstructures. So we have seen that slab type. Again, in slab, there is a solid slab type or voided slab type. If we talk about a material, it may be a RCC, it may be a prestress concrete. RCC will be used for a lesser span. PSC will be used for a higher span, because as we know that in the prestress concrete, we are already introducing a compressive forces, and because of which its moment carrying capacity will be increased, because which counteract the tensile forces. So compressive forces will counteract the tensile forces, and thus thus the capacity moment of resistance of the section would be increased, right? So RCC and PSC, both the options will be there in the solid slab and voided slab. Then after we can go for a multi girder slab and girder. So that is slab and girder kind of a system. Again, RCC and PSC, but RCC will be used for the lesser span. PSC will be used for a higher span. Then box, again, there are two options, RCC as well as PSC box. So this can be used. And then after this up to box, we may use up to a 30 meter, 40 meter. We can go up to a box kind of a superstructures. And then after, we can think of some other innovative options like steel structures or steel concrete composites, or cable suspension bridge, or bowstring girder, or extra produced bridges. So various different options you might have seen that will be fall into a signature bridges, right? Which has a very high aesthetic values, which can cover a very long span, which are somewhat flexible in the nature also in comparison to the traditional solid and multi-girder system. So these kind of options are required to be use it when the span will be large. So all the red color superstructures, red color which I use it here, this will be used for the longer span, maybe more than 40 to 50 meter span will be there, then we can go for such kind of a superstructures. Up to 40 or 50 meter, we can go for a traditional, from up to 50 meter, we can go for this traditional type of a superstructures. So our earlier practice, that is to go for a girder and slab system, or a box girders that is being used. Girder and slab systems are more prominent due to majority of the bridges being small to moderate span. So we can try to accommodate our span in such a manner, wherever there is no restriction, then we can always accommodate the span to our required level. Sometimes in cities, there is a difficulties of accommodating the span. Particularly when we are in a viaduct portion, always we need to go for a larger span. In urban cities like Ahmedabad or metro, wherever there is a viaduct portions, we always need to go for a higher span. So there we can go for a different form of superstructures, which is more suitable for a larger span, right? Otherwise, on a national highways or there, always there is a flexibilities of keeping a span as per our requirement, because if we go for a longer span, more and more on longer span, the cost of the bridge will also increase. So we need to study some economics also for such kind of a things, because budget is always a constraint, and within a stipulated budget we have to work. So that is why traditional kind of a superstructures like a slab and girder is found to be most economical in majority of the situations, right? Whereas in emerging trends for longer span, as we have discussed, continuous superstructures are there. Segmental, nowadays, this is also the thing, segmental construction. Construction is also a very important thing in these situations. So we can go for the construction. Segmental constructions are there where cast in situ or precast construction we can go for. Steel concrete composite construction is there, extra dose cable stay. It is in between kind of a situations, girder bridge and the cable stay bridges. So extra dose is in between situation of a girder bridge and the cable stay bridges, known as extra dose bridges, cable stay bridges, suspension bridges. So all such kind of the bridges are widely are used for the long span situation. Okay? So these are some of the pictures just to have the idea. It is a solid slab type of a superstructures. This is a voided type of a superstructures. You can see that the voids are used. So this type of the voids are used. So this is known as a voids, and by introducing a voids, the depth of the section, the depth of the section will be increased. Okay. So once the depth of the section is increased, the moment of resistance will also increase. Right. So that is why voided type of a sections may be used for little a larger span than the normal slab type of a superstructures. You can see that here the depth of the slab, wherever there is a restrictions of the yield room, we can go for a slab type of superstructures. So the depth of the slab here, and this can be increased by incorporating in voids. And again, here both the options are available, RCC as well as PSC. RCC can be used for a lesser span, and PSC can be used for a higher span. Then multi-girder system. You can see that these type of the girders are used, multi-girder systems are there. So we can go for a multi-girder, number of girder, this kind of a girder. Number of girder is always decided based on how many lanes you want to accommodate, right? So these longitudinal girders are there. The girder which is running along the direction of the traffic is known as a longitudinal girder. And just to connect this longitudinal girder at suitable interval, at suitable length span, we need to provide the cross girder so that longitudinal girders are not going to buckle or it is not going to bend. Okay, so at regular interval, some interval, the cross girders are also required to provide to keep the longitudinal girder into a position. This is a PSC multi-girder systems. Of course, just by the look, you cannot differentiate. But these kind of blisters are provided so that sometimes we need to stretch the wire here, stretch the cables here. These kind of blisters are provided. Otherwise, during construction, you can identify it very well whether it is RCC girder or pistress girder. But once the girder is casted, then it is very difficult to find out, because already these things are to be finished later on. So this is a prestress girder. A box type of superstructure. See, these kind of a box are provided. So box type of a superstructures, maybe full length cast in situ kind of a box is provided, or sometimes precast box is provided, and then after later on it will be casted on the site. So just to have the speed in the construction, precast construction is now widely used in majority of the bridges. So this can be done very well. Balance cantilever kind of a thing. See, there is a variable depth. Always we can see that at the support we need a higher depth to accommodate the shear requirement. Shear requirement is more at the support, and as we move away from the shear requirement is reduced. At the same time, bending moment will be more at the center, and when we move away from the center, the bending moment will be reduced. So these two opposite natures we have to accommodate it very well in the design. Thing is there. These are the different pictures of cables and suspension bridge. So this is our cables when we have to go for a very large span. So then we can go for the cables bridge. Bowstring girders. So here the load transfer mechanism, whenever we go for a special bridges like a suspension bridge or bowstring girders or suspension, cable suspension or arch bridge, the load transfer mechanism is a very important thing to understand. And how the load will be transferred from superstructure to a substructures, that we need to understand. Let us be talking about a bowstring girder. Here the load of the superstructures will be transferred from a suspenders. These are the vertical suspenders are there. And through the suspenders, the load will be transferred on this arch. And from the arch, the load will be transferred on the substructures. So basically, the load transfer mechanism, we need to understand very well whenever we go for a very special or specialized kind of the bridges. Right? Same thing we need to understand in the cable suspension, in the arch bridge also. Okay, so wherever arch, bowstring girder, suspension bridge is there, we need to understand the load transfer mechanism properly, and accordingly in the analysis and design will be carried out. Many times the traditional analysis will also not work. We need to go for a construction stage analysis also, right? And for that we need to use a good software. See, sometimes the simple method, mechanics will not work. Here we need to understand a construction sequence properly, and accordingly analysis will be also taken care of using such kind of a construction sequence. Right? So when we are talking about the different forms of the superstructures, there are different criteria. For span up to 10 meter, we can go for a RCC solid slab kind of a superstructures. 10 to 20 meter, one can go for a multi girder system. Multi girder will be depend on the number of lanes to be accommodated. So girder and slab type of a system will be suitable when we go for 10 to 20 meter. 20 to 30 meter, one can go for a PSC girder type or a box type of a superstructures. 30 to 40 meter, one can go for a PSC box girder or PSCT girder kind of a superstructures. 40 to 50 meter, we can go for a PSC box. And when it is more than 50 meter, we can go for either a truss bridge, suspension bridge, cable stay bridge, bowstring girder, extra doors. There are various other options are there. This is just a tentative guideline, right? Based on the experience of many designers, they have derived through the various options and cost economics is carried out, and based on that this criteria are decided, right? So this may not rigidly you can use it, but it is obvious that for a lesser span you can go for a slab, or if you progressively go for a small span, we can go for a solid slab. Then after voided slab, then after slab and girder kind of a system, then after box type of a system, and again in this range, wherever lower range we can go for a reinforced concrete, and higher range we can go for a PSA, prestressed concrete kind of a things. Different component is concerned, we have already discussed, there is a deck, wearing codes, footpath, safety curb, drilling, expansion joint. So these are the different component of the superstructures. Carriageway width, that is the minimum distance between the inside face of the roadway, a curb or the wheel cad. So these are certain terminology one has to understand whenever we design the bridges. So this is the minimum width that is required to be provided. For different component, like see, already IRC has prescribed different guidelines for deciding the carriageway width. So we need to understand the, we need to go through the IRC guideline for using such kind of deciding the carriageway width, how many lanes we need to accommodate. So of course, various traffic studies are also required to be carried out, and based on that, one can decide the number of lanes and all the things, right? Or let us say the two lane without footpath. These are the length which is prescribed by the IRC, that at least we need to provide a this much 12.9 meter of the cross section of the bridges are required to provide. If with footpath, then 1.5 meter footpath is may be provided on both the sides or on one side, and where, because always the space is always a matter of constraints. So based on whatever constraints we are having, if there is no constraint, then we need to go for providing a footpath on both the sides. If there is a constraint, at least we can go for providing footpath on one side. If the footpath is also not able to get it, we can go for providing a curb. So depends on the space constraints, we can accommodate the total width of the bridge. Similarly, this is for four lane and six lane divided carriageway. You might have seen traveled on the highway, so you have gone through that the four lane divided carriageway. Nowadays, now almost all the highways are having this kind of a pattern. Four lane divided carriageway width is there. So with footpath, without footpath, what is the total width that you need to provide for the bridges? So this can be decided. And this is similarly for the carriageway width for the culvert. If you need to provide a culvert, then this is the total carriageway width we need to provide with median carriageway width, pave shoulder, earthen shoulder. So in that way, the total width of the culvert that can be decided. These are some of the pictures, footpath, which is whenever is required to provide. Minimum width of the footpath normally provided is 1.5. If the footpath is not able to provide, at least we can go for providing a safety curb of half of the footpath. So this can be provided with a safety curb so that at least the pedestrian can walk. Otherwise, if footpath and safety curb is not there, pedestrian cannot walk over the highway, because as you might have experienced how the vehicles are moving on the highway. So if the pedestrians are allowed on the highway, then always there is a need to provide a footpath or the safety curb. Railings and all the things again decided, where there is a footpath, then railing will be okay. But if there is no footpath, then we have to go for a crash barriers, or the metallic anti-crash barriers are required to be provided so that the vehicle, during the collision condition, vehicle cannot be overtaken, right? Otherwise, it is not going to fall on. Expansion joints always required to provide to cater the expansion and contraction due to the vehicle movement as well as due to the temperature movement. So various kinds of expansion joints are there. Joint is the biggest of issues later on. It is there, so we have to properly choose. Depends on the proper whatever expansion and contraction is possible. So you need to go for an analysis considering the seasonal variation, temperature variation is also required to be studied, taken care, so that the proper longitudinal movement, transverse movement, rotational, everything can be carried out. And bearing is one of the very important element of the bridges. If it is not properly designed, then the bridge life will be reduced, right? So life of the bridges depends on the properly designed bearings, so that all the forces, all the movement will be easily taken care, and so that the life of the bridges will be increased. So these are the rocker bearing, roller elastomeric bearing, various kinds of the bearing, as we have discussed some of the photograph. I will go a little fast because we want to cover more aspect in the things. These are some of the pictures of the fixed bearing. Fixed bearing does not allow you any translation in longitudinal direction or rotational direction, as well as it will not allow any rotational movement also. Right? Whereas free bearings, it will allow the translation in both the direction, and guided bearing will allow the translation in a specific direction. So accordingly, you can design, if you allow the translation in the transverse direction or if you allow the translation in the longitudinal direction, accordingly the direction of this guided bearing shall be put it, right? So guided bearing, whenever you are going to put it, always take care that its direction of this allow, how in which direction you allow the movement, so that we need to understand properly, and accordingly we need to put it, so that we can allow the longitudinal and transverse movement properly, right? So this is a look of some T-girder kind of a bridges. So in this T-girder kind of a bridges, you can see that the different components of the things are there. Main girder, the longitudinal girders. See here, these are the longitudinal girders. Okay. Already it is marked here, right? So this is the main girder. Main girder, you can see here, it is already put it in the arrow, which is running in the direction. This is the direction of the traffic, right? Direction of the traffic is there. So along which, this is a four girder system. So four longitudinal girders are there, two outer girder, two inner girder. So four girder system is there, that is known as a main girder. Then after keep the main girder in position at suitable interval, we need to provide a cross girder. Sometimes it is also called a diaphragm. So when it is provided in between the span, it is known as an intermediate diaphragm. And when it is provided at the end, it is called an end diaphragm or end cross girder. So end cross girder or intermediate cross girders are required to be provided at suitable interval to keep the main girder into position. Below every girder, always there is a need to provide a bearing so that the loads of the main girder will be transferred to the substructure through this bearing. So whenever we provide this bearing, always decide the bearing in such a way that the entire superstructures will be kept in a position. So all the bearings may not be kept as a fixed bearing, all the bearings may not be kept as a free bearing, all the bearing may not be kept as a guided bearing. Again, when we go for a guided bearing, allowing certain bearings so that the longitudinal movement will be put the bearing in such a way that certain way the transverse movement is also allowed. So altogether, if we see in this span, total 8 bearings are there. 4 bearings are there on the left hand side, 4 bearings are there on the right hand side, right? For a particular span I am talking about. Similarly, the next adjoining span, again the 4 bearing will be coming to a one common pier. So if you see that this total 8 bearings are there, so arrangement of the bearing shall be made in such a way that certain bearings are fixed bearing, certain bearings are allowing, certain bearings are free bearing, certain bearings are allowing a movement in the longitudinal direction, and certain bearings are allowing a movement in the transverse direction. So these 8 bearings are to be planned in such a way that all the different kinds of the things, restraints as well as free, can be accommodated so that the functioning of the beams, beam bridges can be done in a right way. Otherwise, if we do not make the proper arrangement, then as we know that the bearings, wrongly placed bearing is also creating a trouble, because once the bearing is going to fail, then entire bridges is going to fail, right? So failure of the majority of the failure of the bridges are found that the bearings are misplaced, right? So placing of the bearing is also a very, very important thing. And so this is just the look of the T-girder kind of a superstructures. The number of girders, here the four girders are provided, ultimately decided based on what is the width you want to accommodate, right? So depends on the width of the bridge, number of lanes you want to accommodate, the width of the bridge will be decided. And once the width of the bridge is decided, then we can go for deciding the number of girders. Okay. So numbers of girder, whether it is a 3-girder or 4-girder or even maybe more than that, it can be decided based on the width to accommodate. So this is the width which is to be provided. Always keep some overhang. Overhang is always having an advantage. So keeping some overhang on both the sides, let us have here the overhang of about 1.5 meter is kept. So this is a overhang on both the sides. We can divide the entire span. 2.5 meter to 3 meter span will be sufficient, because this is a slab. So for a slab, 2.5 to 3 meter span is sufficient. You can accordingly decide the number of girder. Again, see the shape of the girder. Normally in a buildings, we are providing a uniform cross-section for the girders. But you can see here, there is a variable cross-section. See here, this cross-section is widely suitable for a mid-span region, and this kind of a section is suitable at the support. So we are always going for a variable section, particularly in the bridges. As we have discussed that a larger shear is there at the support, so that is why at support, this kind of a section is suitable, and particularly we need to keep a larger bending moment. So larger bending moment where this kind of a bulb is required to provide it, because majority of the reinforcement is provided in the bottom zone as well as top zone, so we can get a larger lever arm. So here bulb kind of a situation is provided at the bottom to accommodate a more number of reinforcement or either a more number of cables. So this kind of cross sections widely you might have seen on majority of the bridges, and that is why there is a variable cross section. And that is why if you have seen in this drawing that particularly in certain zone, right, particularly up to this zone, the support section is there. And in between support to there, here, there is a variation is there. Of course, in a drawing, it is not much, you may not be visible properly, but here I have put the two lines where there is a variation in the cross section, and then after the mid-span section is kept throughout. So likewise, you need to decide the length of the sections, that up to which length what kind of sections are going to be provided, up to which length the support section is provided, then after you can vary the section so that it can match the mid-span section, right? So the cross section is important thing, and next important thing is the depth of the beam, depth of the girder. So for that, you can traditional use our span to depth criteria are available in majority of the codes. So span to depth criteria, you may use it. Span to depth for simply supported, we can go for span to depth of even say 12 to 15 will be suitable. 15 will be used for the prestress section, and 12 may be used for the reinforced concrete section. Okay, so accordingly, the depth of the girder is decided. And once the depth of the girder will be decided, then after we can go for determining the different loads. So for a general design consideration, you will have to follow, because most of the time for the road bridges, we need to follow the IRC loading IRC codes, and different IRC codes I have put it here. IRC 5 is basically use it that is a general design features. So most of the time for the planning point of view, what are the vertical clearances required, what is a span, what is the thing is required. All the general features given in IRC 5. Then loads and stresses, this is given in IRC 6. That is also called a section 2. Here is called a section 1. So section 1 gives the general design features. Section 2 gives all the description of the loads and stresses, load combinations. So everything is given in IRC section 2, IRC 6, section 2. So this is very, very important for the designer. For the designer, they need to understand what amount of load, what type of load, what amount of load which we need to consider. And then after load combination. So all the things are to be described very well in section 2. Then section 3, earlier it was there. That is for the design, just like as IS 456 we were using. For the building, but now IRC 21 and IRC 18, similar IRC 18 is used for the prestress design. So it is as good as IS 1343, which is used for the design of prestress concrete section. So this IRC 21 and 18, which is now combined, and now it will be put it into a IRC 112. So now, since last 2-3 years, IRC 112 is started. Earlier, IRC 21, where the working stress design philosophy was given, but now IRC 112 has given the limit state design philosophy. So now, limit state design philosophy is started in the design of bridges. Earlier, working stress design was used, so which was given in IRC 21. So now this IRC 21 and IRC 18, both the codes are replaced, and now it is not used. And IRC 112, which combines both the reinforced concrete and prestressed concrete design philosophy and related criteria, which is given in IRC 112. So now designer has to go through these IRC 112 for designing the concrete bridges. One need to understand the difference between the building and bridges. Building, there is a less redundancy and the reserve strength. You see, in a building, there are a large number of redundancy. All many members are interconnected with each other, which is not here, and that is why it has a less redundancy. Of course, if it is a simply supported bridge is there, there is no redundancy at all. What is a disadvantage of having this less redundancy is that we don't have any play. If any of the point where the plastic hinge form, the structure is going to collapse from that point, because the mechanization take place and the failure of the structures will take place. So this is the disadvantage of the less redundancy, and that is why we need to always take care more while the designing. There is no non-structural element. In a building, there are many non-structural elements like walls, masonry walls are there, which will take care of some part of the loads, which can resist some part of the energy, which is not available in the bridges. So we need to design for the higher forces. Different component of the bridges having different overstrength and the ductility. Ductility is playing a very important role, particularly for the earthquake forces. Dynamic forces are there. And we have seen that many of the bridges were collapsed because of the lesser ductility during the earthquake. And you found a large number of, I think, the examples for the failure of the bridges during the earthquake. Even in 2001, Bhuj earthquake also, large number of bridges were affected because of the ductility, non-ductile behavior. So no ductility, no overstrength of the connections of the superstructure and substructure. This is a very, very important. that buildings are having a monolithic joint, a beam column joint. There is a monolithic connections which is not here in case of a bridges, right? Superstructures is simply resting over a substructures. There is no connection in between, and that is why this is a very challenging task, particularly for the bridges, to keep the superstructures in position during the earthquake is a challenging task for the designer. And that is why the failure at just one or two points, the entire bridges will put out of functions. And that is why we need to design for a larger seismic coefficient for the bridges than the buildings. Okay. So earlier code has given 1893, but now IRC has also prescribed a separate code for the earthquake resistant design of the bridges. Even IS has also given a separate code for the bridges now or nowadays. 1893 part one, that is given for the building. Now for bridges also a part three or part four is there, that is for the bridges. It is already came up and now it can be used, right? Different types of the loads to be considered in the design of bridges, that is, it is already given in IRC 6, section 2, dead load, superimposed dead load, various other imposed loads are there. So, but of course, static in nature, so that is why it is called a superimposed dead load, a live load, vehicle impact, impact of floating bodies if it is on the rivers or the canals, collision vehicle, wind load, water current, tractive, braking, bearing friction, centrifugal force, particularly when we are designing the bridges in curvature, right? So centrifugal force is there, buoyancy, earth pressure, temperature, deformation effect, secondary effect, erection effect, right? So nowadays, the bridge constructions are going precast in the form of a precast elements. So erection effects are also there, seismic force, wave pressure, grid effect, particularly when we are having a sloping. Most of the time we are during the upstream and downstream of the bridges, we put it on the soil or on the ground. But when the sloping parts are there, upstream as well as downstream, the girders are placed, the grid effect is also required to be provided. Various live loads that we need to consider in the design of the bridges. So IRC 6 has prescribed different class of the live load. It's a hypothetical vehicle, but this hypothetical vehicle is given by the IRC design, hypothetical vehicle designed by the IRC, and accordingly in the design of the bridges, we need to consider this live load. Because all the vehicles are moving, so these are the moving loads, and it is difficult to decide. So class 70 are wheeled vehicle, total 100 ton, see 8 ton, 12 ton, 12 ton, 17 ton, four different axles are there. Okay, so total 100 ton loading is there, IRC wheel load. And this vehicle is required to be traveled on these bridges, and whatever bending moment shear force that is generated due to the movement of this vehicle, that we need to estimate. Okay, so this is an IRC 70R wheeled vehicle. Similarly, track vehicle depends what kind of load, what kind of roads you are having, whether it's a village road or ordinary district road or major district road or state highway or national highway or expressway. So depends on the type of the road, you need to calculate that, you need to consider the type of live load. Okay, so this is class AA track vehicle, which is of the 70 ton vehicle is there. Class A wheel vehicle, 55 ton vehicle is there. Class B, approximately 40 ton vehicle is there. Right. So these are the different types of the hypothetical vehicles which is prescribed by the IRC and which you need to consider in the estimation of estimation of the bending moment and shear force. And now IRC has also prescribed a special vehicle, because you might have seen that the bridge construction is nowadays become a lot of automotive, and very heavy loads are required to be traveled from one point to another point. So total 385 tons. Up till now, only 100 tons, 70 are vehicles were allowed. So when there is a case of more than 100 ton loads are required for the bridges, I think one cannot allow, otherwise the bridges are going to collapse. Okay, so now certain bridges, particularly where defense or such kind of things are there, we can design the bridges for a special vehicle having a 385 tons. Right, so this is also nowadays prescribed by the special vehicle. Of course, all the bridges do not need to design for such special vehicle. It is only very specific bridges where such kind of a things are allowed, movement is allowed, then and then you can go for such kind of. So this everything will be decided by the authority together, by consulting with the authorities. One can decide which kind of vehicle and the type of the bridges. One can decide the type of vehicles. Code has also prescribed the live load combinations. So different depends on the carriage by width and number of lanes. So what combinations of the loads are required to be carried out? Suppose we are going for a three lane bridges. So 2 to 3 lane bridges. Suppose 2 lane bridges are there, then we can go for a 1 lane of class 70R or 2 lanes of class A. That is prescribed. If it is a 3 lane bridges, then 1 lane of class 70R. For every 2 lane with 1 lane of class A.
Sir, I think your voice has gone. It is not audible. Participants, let's wait once the radio, audio that is the record. Yeah, I think sir is having some connection problem. So in due time, he will be joining again. Just wait for a couple of minutes. I have talked with sir, and sir, there is some network issue. He is trying to join soon. So bear with the situation, and sir will be joining soon.
Okay, so we were discussing. Am I audible? Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, it is audible.
So we were discussing about the forces which we need to consider in the analysis and design. So first thing is the vertical reaction from superstructures from both the span. If it is a one span, then it's okay. Otherwise, if it is a adjacent span, then we need to also consider the reaction from the adjoining span or the adjacent span. Many times the center will be center of the cap or that. Sometimes if we have the same span length on both the side, then the reaction may be equal from both the side. But if there is a different span on left side, if there is a different span on the right hand side, then there is a possibility of having eccentricity. And because of this eccentricity, there is also a longitudinal moment. So more longitudinal moment due to a net vertical reaction of the superstructures that we need to consider. Horizontal force due to breaking longitudinal. So due to breaking, due to seismic in longitudinal direction, we need to consider. Transverse moment due to eccentricity of the superstructure. So this is a transverse case. So in a transverse case, the vehicle position is important. Every time the vehicle position may not be in the center. So we, accordingly, the transverse moment that is developed due to the eccentricity of the either superstructures or due to the loading also. In same way, there is a transverse moment due to the horizontal force like a wind seismic, all the things are there. So due to that also there is a transverse moment. So one need to consider all the design, all the forces which would resulted into the reaction, vertical reaction, longitudinal moment and the transverse moment. All the forces we have seen, we have described earlier, which will ultimately result into a vertical reaction or more longitudinal moment or transverse moment, which we need to accommodate, which is going to be at the bearing location accordingly the things will be decided. So this is a RCC tea girder kind of the things, which will be a tea girder bridge. And for that, I will just show you some of the calculations which will have some idea that how the things can be decided. So this cross section, so cross section which is so end cross section, and here provided particularly in this zone, and then end section cross section is provided. So three girder systems are there, three longitudinal girders are there, one intermediate cross girder is there, and two end cross girders are there. So accordingly cross-section. Of course, here the bulb is not capped, and for the mid-span section it is capped less because support here more shear is there. So accordingly, the dimension is capped. In the design steps, there is a data. Load calculation, analysis of superstructure, summary of bending moment force, design the main girder for flexure, for shear, design the deck, design the cross girders, and the detailing. These are the different steps are there. Required, that is a center to center bearing span, carriageway configuration, both main girders, structural property girder, dimension of the deck, grade of the material. Normally here more grade of the concrete is required, 35 by 50. So these kind of grade of materials are used. The reinforced concrete is there, so we can go for and again in the 500 ductile kind of a steel.
Yes, participants, again we found some technical issue. Yes, sir has joined. Sir, your screen is visible, still your mic is off.
Hello.
Hi, yes, sir.
Okay. So now, what is the situation? To what extent can I go?
Sir, actually, we have crossed the limit.
Nearly 120-130 is about to go. Right? Yes. It's,
So
I think I'll just take complete this RCC bridge. We'll not take more than 5 minutes, and then after I think we stop it. We'll not go cover the
pre-stress. Yeah.
Pre-stress.
Okay. Okay, sir.
First, yeah. Pre-stress will take a little more.
Okay, sir.
Right. So for analysis is concerned. There are various manual methods are available, but nowadays people are not going for manual method. People are using for standard ready-made softwares. Standard bridges softwares are also available, particularly to a bridges. But if you have a STED kind of a things, STED or SAP, then also you can use such software for making such kind of a model that is known as a grill edge model. This grill edge model is very well used for a T-beam, T-girdle slab and beam type of a slab and girdle type of a superstructures. So here, this can be divided into a number of grids, and properties of the grids can be given based on whether the girder is available or slab is available. So accordingly, we can give the properties of the girders or slabs here in the form of a grid, and the grill edge analysis is carried out. Second part is the moving load analysis. Moving load analysis, as you know that if we are doing manually, then we need to go for a influence line diagram. But nowadays, I think entire structural analysis is to be carried out with the help of a computer software. And STED and SAPS kind of a software can easily carried out such kind of a task. So you can very well do this in a grill edge analysis with the help of a moving loads, and all the things can be done, or even with all the load combinations. Of course, if the bridge software is there, where all the combinations are customized, otherwise you will have to give one by one combination as per our requirement, and we can go accordingly. So after having for grill edge analysis, we can finally get the analysis result, that is dead load moment, dead load for dead load moment and shear for exterior girder, interior girder, due to live load, due to SIDL. For all the different kind of the loads which we have considered, we are able to get the bending moment and shear, and that too with the exterior and interior girder. A moving load is also there, so we can go for a appropriate combination considering all the limit state criteria. All the load combinations are prescribed by the limiting load which are required to be carried out, or the safety, that is a load factor which is given by the code. So you can combine, make the appropriate combination and find out the extreme, for extreme condition, what are the dead load moment, SI load, SIDL, live load moment, and total moment for outer girder, inner girders. Everything we can very well get it through the help of a computer software. And once the software is able to get it, then after we can go for the detailing part. And in the detailing part, one can easily get the things, that is the things, right? Drawings, later on, all the design calculations needs to be carried out. And for design calculations, one can go for the Excel spreadsheet kind of a things can be carried out. And with the help of a spreadsheet, we can go for the things, right? So I think as the time is short, I'm not going to discuss much thing. I'm not going to show you the Excel spreadsheet and the drawings, because this takes some little more time. So I'll stop here. Design and detailing, I think many of you are quite aware about, because we are doing in the RCC in the building design or so. So likewise, you may use a certain spreadsheet for designing the different components. Of course, some softwares which are specifically for the bridge design, they are also providing you the detailed design calculations, and this can be later on put it for the detailing, right? So I think with this thing, I'm going to stop here, because we are already over running the time. So that is why I'm not going for the priestess girder, but else otherwise the time was there, we could also discuss the same thing. So I think with this thing, I'm just stop my talk here. If anybody have any questions, let us have the let us discuss and complete these sessions.
Yes, sir. There are a few questions. So one by one, I'll go through. Which software can be used for construction stage load analysis for innovative bridge systems?
So softwares like MIDAS, M-I-D-A-S, MIDAS, LUSAS. So these are very specific. These are very specific software for the design of bridges. So one has to go for such kind of a design of a signature bridges. I think one can go for MIDAS and LUSAS. So these are the things. Otherwise, this STAAD and SAP can be used, but we have to compromise to a many stages, right? Or you are very good as far as the idealization is concerned. If you are good in the idealization, then your SAP and STAAD may be used, but the thing is there. Second part is there, some advanced construction stage analysis, temperature kind of a things, temperature analysis, continuous, when we are going for a continuous superstructures. So continuity due to the effect of continuity, particularly pre-stress, when we are going for the pre-stress bridges. So the effect of continuity and all these things will also inducing the secondary stresses. So the secondary stresses, analysis of the secondary stresses and all these things are found to be very difficult for the STAAD and SAP kind of a software. So for such kind of the special bridges, I think one need to go for a MIDAS or USAS or such kind of a things are there. If the major bridges are there, tall bridges, major bridges are there, then we need to also go for a detailed dynamic analysis. Of course, in my talk, I have not discussed much about the dynamic analysis. But when the bridges are a long span, we need to consider the seismic force. And at that time, the dynamic analysis is also required to be carried out. Code has prescribed a certain criteria under which one need to go for a dynamic analysis. And detailed dynamic analysis is required to be carried out. So at that time also, the traditional software like STAAD and SAP would not be much fruitful or would not be much useful. So you have to go for such kind of a software, right?
Okay. So next is, which type of bearing should be used, elastomeric or POT?
Elastomeric bearing, where earlier it was used in majority of the bridges. But nowadays, it is preferred to go for a pot PTFE kind of a bearing. And again, in a pot PTFE kind of a bearing, I have discussed very detailed in during my lecture that there are three types of bearing: fixed bearing, free bearing, and a guided bearing. You have to make a appropriate choice of the fixed bearing, free bearing, and guided bearing at the bearing location. On the bearing location, you need to put a appropriate choice so that the longitudinal movement is also allowed, permitted, as well as transverse movement is also permitted. And at the same time, fixity is also to be achieved. Otherwise, the entire span will be collapsed. We have seen many times that if the bearings are not properly placed, so during construction even, some of the girders are fallen from the position. We have found many such example of falling of the girders. That is because of the wrong choice or placing of the bearings, right? So bearings should be properly designed. So that all the design forces, as well as movement, particularly whatever movement you want to allow, that accordingly it will be manufactured. Okay.
Yes, sir. Then as we have highway bridge, railway bridge, metro bridges, so how to consider load case in particularly for metro bridges or so?
Metro bridges as such, there is no Indian code is not available right now. but we can consider the railway because loadings are as good as the railway. Railway loadings are already given in their standards. IRS, Indian Railway standards are available, just like as IRC. IRS standards are available. So I think in IRS standards, the loads are prescribed. Of course, metro loads are comparatively are lesser than the railway loads. Standard railway loads are there. Compared to that, the metro loads are comparatively lesser. Right. So all the bogies and all the weights and loads are prescribed. So if this thing, if these loads are available, we can easily carry it out. Then there is no much difference between the road bridges and the railway bridges. Some dynamic effect and all the things are little different in comparison to the road bridges. So which we need to consider from the
yes, sir. Bridges. Yes, sir. And next question is, I think it is for some figure. If expansion bearing is provided only one out of four as per the image shown, does it not create any differential movement?
Only one means, I could not understand. Only one means.
In one of the figure, it would be like, suppose four girders are there, and out of this four girders, only one expansion bearing is provided.
No. Expansion, see, expansion bearing, sorry, expansion bearing, it's not like, bearing is there. Bearing allows a movement in longitudinal direction, transverse direction, or even in both the direction, as well as rotational direction. Right. So I, of course, the figure, it was not much clear, but bearing, there is a separate drawing for the bearing showing that which bearing allows movement in which directions. Okay. So total four bearings, as I have shown on the left hand side, even four bearings there on the right hand side, each bearing we have to prescribe properly that which would be a fixed bearing, which would be a free bearing, which would be a guided bearing. If it is a guided, there in which direction, all the things that will be decided by the designer. Right? Designer has to decide.
So I think it is for free bearing and fixed bearing. The statement has come.
Free, fixed, as well as guided. Yeah. All the three things we need, because all bearings may not be a, cannot be a fixed bearing, all bearings cannot be a free bearing, and all bearings cannot be a guided bearing. So there should be a, out of total eight bearing on the left hand side, let us say some bearings, two bearings, we can keep it a fixed bearing. So these two bearings which we are going to fix, so the opposite on the right hand side, we can allow a guided bearing allowing a longitudinal movement in the longitudinal directions. Okay, then other two bearings allow the movement in the transverse direction. So likewise, there should be we have to make a combinations, and designer has to see that the structure should remain in proper position.
And,
even during construction also. This, because many times we have seen that there are cases we found that because of the wrong placing of the bearings, girders collapse or fallen. Of course, live loads are not there, but some vehicles are traveling for transporting many, many, many loads. So at that time also the vehicles, girders were fallen, right?
Okay, and again, in that connection, the statement has come, I think, Mr. Dhawan, I have allowed you to talk.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes.
It's like, I had a doubt. It's like only out of the four girders, if some are guided bearings and some are free bearings. So if one out of four girder is a free bearing, so does that mean only that single girder is moving, or if the structure is moving monolithically and only the movement is allowed through that particular girder?
See,
I was unable to comprehend.
See, structure ultimately, when it is a slab and girder type of thing, that will behave in a monolithic way. Finally, it will be a monolithic. There is nothing like an individual, because finally all the girders are connected through intermediate diaphragm, intermediate cross girder, as well as at the top through the slab. Right.
Yes.
So entire system becomes a one rigid body, and that will behave like a rigid body mechanism.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
So later on, they want to behave just like as an individual element.
So if you are allowing the movement, so there should be a gap between two spans for the movement, isn't it? Or the road surface is casted throughout. Will there be a gap between the
gap is there, but that gap will be provided with the expansion joint. So expansion joint is there in between. So this will be taken care of such a rotational movement.
Okay, fine. I guess that's it. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
So I think we have covered almost all the questions. So at this time again, I'm thankful to Dr. B.J. Shah for sparing his valuable time and accepting our invitation. So on behalf of Marwadi Education Foundation as well as Atal Academy, I'm thankful to Sasar. And still, if more questions are there through the participants, then we'll be in touch with you through mail.
Sure. I'm really very happy to deliver here. Of course, some disturbances was there in between. My network has gone for some time. So due to that, some disturbances is there. But little pardon for that.
Actually, it is technical error, but now we have to consider it as a natural error. Sometimes it happens.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you all, organizer as well as participants, for patiently hearing.
Okay.
And giving me a chance to deliver, interact with all of you.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Yeah.
And participants, still we have more than half an hour time. So today, as the lecture has prolonged, we will try to take the lunch within the time frame itself and we'll continue with our schedule. So just manage your lunch within the time frame and we'll start the session as per regular schedule. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.